Thank you all.
Good afternoon. I'm Erin.
I'm Miguel.
And I'm Austin.
And we're from Team DIVA, which stands for Data Imaging and Visualization Analysis, and we're going to present our thesis proposal today. So just a brief overview of the presentation. I'm going to go over some background and then some past research from our literature review and go into our solution to those problems and propose our research question, and then we'll talk about our methodology for our project. So the motivation behind our project is that we are collecting terabytes of climate data, and we need better ways to process, analyze, and visualize this data. And current methods of doing this are difficult to interact with because it's hard to view multiple variables at one time, it's difficult to observe correlations between different data sets, and it's difficult to kind of zoom in and look at areas of specific interest. So to give you some examples of past research that we've run into where we think these kinds of things could be improved, I'm just gonna go through a few examples. So the first example is just 2D color maps, which are pretty common. These are usually static images or animated images, but if you zoom in, there isn't really a lot of extra detail given by that. This one is an example of mean surface temperature. And you can see that there's a color scale on the bottom, but we're losing some of the contrast in the data because these darker colors are never used in the map. Another example where you're able to view more than one variable in this type of format are two-variable color maps or bivariate color maps. And this gives you a little bit more information because you can see from this scale, there's kind of four extremes. This one is a graph of temperature versus humidity, and you can see hot and dry areas versus cold and dry areas and so forth. So it's a little bit more interactive. A third example that we came across were glyph maps. You can use these to view trends in certain things, such as this one, which shows temperature in specific regions over time. So you can see that the trends in the ocean are clearly different from those on land, but it's difficult to extract specific data values from this type of map, and they're not interactive, they're usually static. A more recent format of data visualization is 3D globes. This is an example from NASA's Whirlwind software, and you can see wind vectors from a tropical cyclone pictured here, but we believe that this type of technology could be expanded further to include more interactivity of the data. So our solution to this problem is to utilize virtual reality to allow you to really get in there and view 3D data as it should be viewed in 3D. So for our research questions for this project, we want to ask, in terms of computation time, what features we include, computational storage, and effective design, how can we create a virtual reality climate visualization tool for data? And we also want to know what the most user-friendly, aesthetically pleasing, and informative ways are for scientists and the general public to visualize this climate data using virtual reality. So to discuss how we're going to accomplish this, I'm going to hand it off to Miguel, who's going to talk about our methodology.
All right. So our first order of business is to pick a virtual reality device. We chose the Oculus Rift, mostly because it's the most widely used VR device. It includes head and position tracking. And most recently, a couple months ago, they introduced the Oculus Touch, which allows for controls, as you see in the picture here. Well, whereas before, we just had the headset. And they also have a React VR web interface where you can develop like on the web browser instead of directly on your machine. Next, we'll talk about our workflow. So for our workflow, we have the user's Oculus, which basically handles the visualizations. And the user would develop like on the React VR web interface, and then all of the computational instructions we get sent to a GPU cluster. This is to ensure that we have it's efficient to do all the computations there rather than rely on the user's machine, which may not be as powerful. And then all of those computations would get sent back through the web interface and through the user's Oculus. And this is where we plan to have the user's Oculus deal with the actual visualizations. Say if they want an animation of sorts, we don't want to keep sending data back and forth to the GPU cluster because there could be some variation in the internet connectivity as well, which would slow things down. Next, once we've chosen our device, we need to choose a platform to develop our program in. There are two main engines. Here I'll talk about Unity. Unity 5, the current version, it uses C# and its own version of JavaScript, which they call UnityScript. Some of the advantages of Unity is that it's less resource intensive, which means you don't need a hugely powerful laptop or computer to develop on it. But some of the disadvantages is that we're using a file called netcdf, which is one of the most common data types which we use to read climate data from. And to do that, because it's not a very common file format other than for using climate data, we need libraries in order to read it. And one of the disadvantages for Unity is that there's no netcdf library written directly in C# or JavaScript. And so now we have to turn to because there isn't anything natively written in it, we have to rely on .NET. So with .NET 4.0 and above, there are netcdf packages available. But with Unity, the .NET version isn't high enough. And just right now it's 3.5, but that was only recently updated from 2.0 a couple of weeks ago. And so the bottom line, and also another disadvantage, is that their Unity script, it breaks a lot from the norm of JavaScript. So users who are versatile in JavaScript, they can't easily port to Unity script because a lot of the basic rules are broken. And bottom line is that we must wait until a version of Unity can support .NET 4.0 and above. And unless that gets released in 1 to 2 months, we won't develop in Unity 5. For that reason, our chosen engine was Unreal. For Unreal Engine, it uses unmodified C++, which means users who know C++ can directly port over and without any rule breaking with Unity's JavaScript. Some of the advantages is that the netcdf library is written in C, so it's a simple integration and library import. There's more potential for better graphics in Unreal. And also we have, in Unreal, there's something called Blueprint Mode, which is like a high-level prototype you can do with, you know, you can replace, so you can drag and drop shapes such as spheres and cubes and see how, like, you can manipulate it, how, like, if you click play, what would happen, kind of like a very advanced preview mode. But the main disadvantage is that it's very resource intensive, which means the bar for the laptop to run it, it's very high. And at this point, only about 3 or 4 people on our team can run it without any huge issues. And so in the future, we plan to utilize the supercomputer, which where we can host Unreal Engine. So anybody can just log into that, can log into that supercomputer and use it to capabilities. And as I said before, this is our platform for choice on this project. Now for our current progress, we're able to read in, this is done in Unreal, like I said before, we're able to read in and display an entire netcdf file for one variable. This globe, it's an animation of the mean sea level pressure across the Earth for the entirety of 2002 in 6-hour time increments. And so this globe is just animated through all of those. It's about 1,400 timestamps, and it's animated through all of them. And so our future goals would be to display multiple variables. So if you want to also display pressure on this, for example. And if we have data that are given at different heights or different altitudes, we want a way to render those as well. Like the animation would be if you go down through it and up there, you can see different slices. And we would also want tools to identify meaningful correlations among data, which were previously unnoticeable based on the visualizing the data. And we would also want to interface with maps. As you can see, there's no continents drawn yet, so that's another immediate goal. And we would also want to adjust color scheme, so if the user somehow doesn't like this color scheme, we can change it. And now I'll ahead and hand it off to Austin to talk about our focus groups and surveys.
Thank you. Cool. So after we finish our first prototype, we'll move on to product improvement, and we plan on doing that through the use of focus groups. We'll have 3 focus groups. For each focus group, we plan on having 2 team members asking guided questions in order to facilitate good discussions on our device and prototype. We also intend to record these discussions of the focus groups. We obtained IRB training recently this winter, and we'll go for IRB approval in order to actually conduct these focus groups. So for our focus groups, our first focus group that we intend to do is our 5 graphic experts. These graphic experts will come from the UMD area. Hopefully they'll be professors from UMD or the like. The goal of this focus group is in order to improve the aesthetics of our prototype, to make it look nicer. After we do that, we plan on improving our tool so that the aesthetics are nicer, so that it's easier to read. And then after that, we'll have our second focus group. The second focus group will be consisted of UMD students. We plan to have 30 students from UMD broken into 5 groups of 6, and the goal of this focus group will be to get broad feedback of our device so that the general public, so we understand how the general public will be able to see our device and use our device, and how they understand the data that they see from this device. After we improve our device so that the general public will be able to understand it better, we intend to go to climate experts who will be actually be able to utilize the tool much more efficiently than the general public will. The goal of this focus group will be to, in order to improve our tool so that the people who actually use the device can use it to its maximum efficiency. After that, we'll go on to further product evaluation through the use of surveys. The surveys will be convenient just because that's the easiest to do relative to the scope of the project, consisting mostly of students from around the UMD area and climate experts from the UMD area, most likely from NOAA. We'll have about 50 new participants from the general public for the first survey. We'll record their ratings on each of the devices. We'll compare between most likely Whirlwind and our prototype. And then we'll see how the ratings compare based on the questions and survey that we give them. We also will have a targeted survey. This targeted survey will be done in order to conduct how fast they are able to complete certain tasks. This is more geared towards the research experts, but it will also be done towards the general public in order to see how they complete tasks and at what speed and efficiency. Our hope for this survey is to show that our device is much stronger than Whirlwind and able to give them much more impact in when they see the data, and so that they are able to understand the data far more efficiently. So let's talk about our future plans. For our budget, right now we plan on doing a launch UMD. It's estimated about 500 per team member. We recently lost a team member, so this will be 3,500 instead. There's also the money that we get from Gemstone, which is $600 every year, and it goes away at the end of the year if we don't spend it. In terms of our spending, we plan on buying our first Oculus Rift this spring after the launch UMD, and we plan on purchasing a second Oculus Rift in the fall of 2018. Both of these Oculus Rifts come with the Oculus Touch, and they each cost $800. After that, we plan on compensating the student surveys and the student focus groups, and in addition to the graphic experts and the climate experts, but for graphic experts and climate experts, most likely the compensation will be towards refreshments and food to make sure to entice them to come. In addition to that, the rest of our money will be going towards conferences and travels in order to understand what other devices are coming out or to show off our device. So let's talk about our timeline for the future. Last semester, we were working on finding what platforms we wanted to use and what devices we wanted to use, as well as creating our first prototype and starting to work on developing it further. This coming semester, we plan on doing our launch UMD, hopefully raising a good amount of money. And then we plan on finishing our first prototype and hopefully having it done around this spring or summer, this summer. After we do that, we'll launch our first focus group, which is the graphic experts. And then we'll improve our device further. After we finish our second prototype, it's on to our next focus group, roughly around hopefully the spring or fall of the next year. And then improving our device further into our final prototype, we'll get into the climate experts, which will probably be around roughly 2019. And then after that, it's just final touches, finishing our thesis, and then presenting our thesis at senior conference. I'd like to give our special thanks to Dr. Stephen Penny, our mentor, to Dr. Kelly O'Neill, our librarian, to Dr. Kristen Scandal, Dr. Frank Cole, and Vicky Hill, the Gemstone staff, and Rofei Du for being here to acknowledge our project. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good job. Well, yeah. We'll start with questions.
Yeah, okay.
Our expert.
Thank you for a great presentation. So I have a few questions about your technical platform choice. You were talking about using a GDOL in your proposal documents, and today you are talking about using Unreal Engine as your platform. So are you going to use Java or are you going to use Unreal with C eventually? So there's a little contradictory between your proposal documents and your presentation today, because I didn't search for any Unreal Engine in your proposal, right?
So I think for now we plan to use Unreal in the future. Mostly because unless, as I said before, Unity is their version of JavaScript, and C#, they're very low right now. And the NCDF libraries, they weren't written with that low of a
version.
So
yeah.
That's why we plan to use Unreal for now. Unless Unity comes up with a higher version, a version which supports a higher version of C# in the very near future, we stick with Unreal.
I think then you have to get rid of React VR as well as Java from your proposal, because actually React VR is JavaScript based, and Java is Java, so Unreal is like in C. So putting all this together in a proposal will lead to misconception.
I think what we meant was that we use Unreal for like actually generating like the objects in the resolution, but like for actually generating like the computation, we use like React VR. So we won't code like we won't do everything in Unreal. Unreal is mostly like part to
the problem is that the React VR is a renderer, which means it does not involve with data processing. React VR is for rendering the final visualization. So I'm wondering what kind of language or what kind of library you use for data processing.
I think we were going to try to stick with C for data processing.
This is the answer I want.
Yeah.
Okay. So you have to get rid of React VR from your proposal, because it has nothing to do with React VR right now. Unreal is Unreal. The other question is that there's a system architecture figure in your presentation which mentions GPU cluster. And I will correct you that you are not going to use GPU cluster, but GPU cluster usually means a bunch of GPU machines, which and the other word you mentioned in your presentation is supercomputer, which are you really considering using supercomputer in your project?
We have been considering both options. We're looking into AWS as one option,
GPU2
as a second option. So we just needed a more powerful platform to do the computations and renderings on.
Okay. Usually a supercomputer means a dedicated computer which has like thousands of CPUs or thousands of GPUs to process large climate data. And AWS, the Amazon Cloud Drive, is like a cloud computing. So you can mention using cloud computing, but do not use the word supercomputer. It's just a correction for particular words. And also GPU cluster means a lot of machines with a lot of GPU chips, which I don't think you can use GPU cluster in this scenario. It's just not the correct word. Okay. Let me see what else. As for user study, so the third user study you are talking about, user focus group with experts. I'm wondering what kind of research questions are you going to ask the experts to conduct in your validation system? Have you ever considered that?
I believe what we're trying to do is give them certain data sets and see how well they can read the data sets, basically, compared to the
to other validation methods. That seems a good plan. And you can correct the word focus group for the third one with case study, because usually we call that a case study with domain experts. Yeah, it's not a focus group. Focus group means a lot of audience discussing for a particular goal. But a case study means we want to study a research question with experts, and we observe how the experts perform given two different tasks and compare different methods. So, and you need to apply, for example, t-test on your case study. Okay, cool. So to me, it's a very promising and interesting project. It's looking forward to the progress.
Thank you. I just think one comment. So the users at the expert level are running on supercomputers and systems that have GPU allocations.
Mm-hmm.
So that is one application that I'd like them to pursue. I'm not sure the differences in the actual implementation that would impact whether they apply this on a cloud computing platform or a supercomputing platform. But that is one of the main platforms that primary users in the research community would be implementing it on.
Yeah, I see. The reason that the climate experts are using supercomputer is because the amount of data they use is huge. So my question is, how large is your data right now for rendering such a 3D globe?
The test form that we had up there was pretty small. It was only a 78x78 grid.
Yeah.
So the overall file was like kilobytes.
Yeah, that's kind of my argument that for an undergraduate project, you can hardly reach with such a huge TB of data. Usually you are dealing with a small amount of data that you don't have to use supercomputer or GPU cluster. What you will use is only, actually, currently one GPU already has thousands of kernels inside the GPU, so you can use parallel computing on one GPU to compute everything. And the other option is to use cloud computing to compute everything parallelly. But even for gigabytes of data, the cloud computing and the one GPU with thousand kernels can deal with that efficiently, and you don't really have to use supercomputer. That's my point.
But that's their test data, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Eventually, 500 terabytes or more. Usually these data sets are stored on local systems, so researchers may be running it on a supercomputing system. They aren't in a position to transfer that data somewhere else to analyze it. So it needs to be analyzed directly on the machine that they're running their simulation on.
I see.
So it's not that they necessarily have to be on that platform, but if they want to support those users, they have to be able to support that platform.
I see. So if I'm understanding correctly, so there are two phases. The first one is like data analyze, which runs on supercomputer. The other is data rendering part. And does the data rendering part involve with supercomputer or not?
That's a question. The analysis is done in the supercomputer.
I see. Yeah.
There are often, most of the more recent supercomputing systems, they've had GPU allocations.
Mm-hmm.
And because people are not accustomed to those GPUs, they rarely get used. So there are GPUs that are basically sitting dormant.
I see.
So I had I thought there may be an opportunity to utilize those GPUs because they're basically being unused. If it's more efficient to transfer or to run that data basically from the login nodes or some other means, then maybe that's satisfactory. But it seems a resource that's sort of untapped. That if it were possible to connect the rendering to the GPU allocation of the supercomputer, it may provide a value to that, where right now it's has limited use.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. Yeah, but it really depends on what eventual, how large is your data, is your final data.
Sure. I've already asked them lots of questions, so I just had a question about your timeline. With the you had planned a campaign, a funding campaign.
Yep. Yeah.
And it was, what was the
once you need.
What was the semester or the timeline for that?
This semester. We have to do it after this event. In order to get
Okay.
So we're hoping to get on the stage for Maryland Day because that tends to bring in a lot of donations.
Okay. I guess you had mentioned that you can basically only do that once during your...
You can potentially do it twice.
Okay. I was just thinking that it may be advantageous to wait until you have like something really flashy and impressive that you can circulate to get more interest. But if you can do multiple cycles, then I guess that's not a problem.
And really with the launch UMD, that's one of the pieces I have. I just need to see your application and then we can get that submitted after today. But what you'll want to think about is how much energy will your team have at what point? Because it does take, it's only a 30-day cycle. It's like a Kickstarter crowdsource. But you have to, everyone needs to participate actively in those 30 days. And one of our team bacteria actually just well exceeded their goal. By I think $2,000. So you set your goal, but exceeding the goal is a good thing. So it's possible you could double what you want if everyone puts in the effort. And you can certainly do it twice, but then you just have to make sure you have a network that you're willing to ask for money more than once. But I'm happy to talk to whoever is leading that effort anytime.
Me?
Yeah?
Were you
sure,
So I guess, first of all, excellent presentation. I really enjoyed it. And I'm super excited for this project. I think it's really great work that you're doing. So it's really exciting to see it progressing. And, you know, I look forward to putting on the headset and seeing what it has. I just have a few comments. And they're kind of all over the place. So I'm going to, some of it's kind of already been addressed. But in terms of your budget, do you have access to RIF technology now that you can
develop
with?
We do have access based, because there's a VR club at UMD, so they have all the Oculus Rifts, so we can go to their labs and basically mess around with their VR devices.
We also have it in the libraries.
Oh, really?
So if you
Preston Tobery?
Yeah, through him. Yep. So we have our makerspace, and we have it within the makerspace. And if there were, you know, sufficient reason that we needed to purchase more, that could be an option too. Just in terms of thinking of your budget, and if you're going to hold off on your launch campaign and you need to, you know, save money, that could be an option for you.
I think we've been in contact with him, and we're just waiting to hear back, so you might see us there.
Okay. Well, I can ping him, too.
And he'll be here at 4 o'clock for Team Walk's presentation, so you might be able to catch him right before as well.
I'll let myself in for that, too. I was also going to suggest Maryland Day, but you're already on top of that. I have a question about your public testers, so in particular your students. Do you have some kind of sampling scheme in mind? So are you going to look for students across many different majors, ranging from STEM, humanities?
Yeah.
So, okay, all right, so you're going to look for a really wide base to test this. Okay. And then in terms of the data set you want to put in, so the examples you showed, you had atmospheric, of course, and then I think you had oceanic, I'm not sure. Were you going to include anything like terrestrial, so looking at, you know, carbon estimates, for example, which would feed into climate change, or pulling, for example, there's MODIS and VIRS data sets for, you know, all sorts of things related to, you know, carbon. Did you have any plans for that as well, for layering?
We haven't looked into it yet, but if it's in a compatible file format, we can easily fit that in. That's definitely an option that we'd want to include.
Okay. And so the other thing is, I don't know if you've come across this yet, but Penn State has a similar project going on that might be worthwhile checking out. I saw a demo of some work that they'd started with last fall, but they were taking a different approach than what you're doing. So they were actually looking at graphs of climate data where you could go in virtual reality and move things around in the graphs, but not a globe. But it was interesting and in some ways similar to what you're doing and in many ways not. But it might be worth looking in on their project. I can't find anything that they have published at this point. I think they're pretty new. I want to say it started last summer. So at this point they have a website and I'm happy to send that if you just want to keep up on that.
I think it's a workshop paper.
It's
called Immersive Visual Analytics for Integrated Assignments of Climate Change.
Yep. And I think that's about all they have right now. So it might be interesting to see what they're doing. And then one final comment. So in terms of you talked about layering, having several data sets, and you can slice through for elevation. In terms of ways of viewing things at once, you know, have you looked at things like, you know, transparencies and swiping and all that? Okay, so you're already on top of all of that. Some of the GIS type stuff. I think that was all I had for you guys. Yeah, I think that's all I have.
Thank you.
So thinking about your focus groups, it was helpful when you went through them, so there was a little more depth in your presentation than in your paper. So you may want to take some of what you've talked about and document that a little bit more. But whoever is leading the IRB charge, I'd like to meet with before, because I think that will help. We can do virtually or in person, since I'm the IRB liaison for Gemstone. So if you go through Gemstone, I'm who will sign off on it. You go through Dr. Penny's department, your IRB liaison will sign off on it. either one is fine, just please loop me in, because for the compensation on the back end, Vicky will need the IRB approval information to get the money from the comptroller. So with that, I wanted to ask, in thinking about the purpose of the focus groups or case study, whatever, however you frame it, do you need the general students if they're not your target audience?
We wanted to make sure that our overall interface and everything was usable and understandable to these climate experts who may be used to working with older technologies. So we want to ensure that it's really clear how to intuitively operate it before we hand it off to people who have been used to working with these technologies for years and years and years. So it's hopefully easier for them to port over. So that was our goal with that second focus group.
Because it seems to me that someone who's unfamiliar with the data, what they would want from it would be very different than someone who's an expert on that topic. So the results you get may look very different. And so I don't know if you need to do 30 students necessarily, or even to do them necessarily in sequence. Like maybe you do 10 students and then 5 experts. And if it was helpful, then you can go back and do 10 more students and then 5 experts to refine it. But you might think about it a little more iteratively. Because they just seem like very different needs from the interface. And also with the survey and looking at the sample you have, tell me about why you need the demographic information.
I think we just wanted to be able to control for any confounding variables, especially like with age, which could be already with their familiarity with technology or anything.
Just because the more demographic information, the slower the IRB process is. So, you know, depending on if you're not going to use that information in any analysis, then you don't need to ask it, and then you probably can just do a human subjects determination form and not worry about it. If you're going to use that information, then you should absolutely ask it. But it's not, you don't need more data just to have more data. So think about how you want to do that. What's your plan for data security?
For
all of it. Well, I mean, some of it, like the climate data are public data, some of them. But how might you control for the interface and those pieces?
So you're asking like how we're gonna secure our like work on the laptop?
Mm-hmm.
Well, since we might implement sort of a cloud interface where you can, you know, send in your file and have it be processed and rendered on some other computer, we do have to think about how we're gonna ensure that transaction can't be breached.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's a good point that we need to consider.
And I think that mostly because FedCentric is sponsoring the Junior Colloquy Award next year, that's something that they asked about, so it sparked my thinking on for many of our teams who have data, even some of the biology teams, how are they securing their lab data? It's something that we don't often think about on the front end. But they are a resource for you all. They think they'd be happy to talk with you. And they do have some supercomputing and GPU power that I think they would be willing for you all to use, maybe even at no cost, if you don't already have access to that. And then Team Armit, which is a junior team, they're also doing a virtual reality projects. They have Oculus technology, and Dr. Dean, their mentor, is in IPST, forget what that stands for. But he has a lot of equipment that I think he would be happy to also share with you all. Because they used the initial Oculus Rift, they actually had to...
They
took a Kinect and used like a Kinect and created some new equipment to help. Because they were using the Oculus Rift with UAV technology, so they were kind of bringing together all of these pieces because they needed to have some control. So anyway, they might be someone to talk to if you haven't connected with them already. There's no sense recreating the wheel completely. And they won the FedCentric competition this year for cyber team. So I think it would be worth talking to them. And I think those were all my sort of comments, questions related to your project in particular, but a question I ask all of the teams at this stage is how are you all going to hold each other accountable and divide up the work and think about how you function as a team through this process?
We have a set of team norms with like punishments, not harsh punishments, but you know, just things to keep each other on track if we don't get working on time. And one thing that I've noticed that we're really good at is setting internal deadlines. So we'll look at when we need to have something done by and say we have to have this done at least a week before. And we've been really good up to this point at getting things done and having that extra buffer week to check it over and edit it and things. So I think we're pretty good on that front with our team norms.
So Jensen teams in general, from this stage forward, you all are on your own in terms of working together with your mentor. We're here to support you the whole time. So anything you need, let us know. But in terms of setting deadlines, you'll have your next milestone as junior colloquia. But some teams fall in a very quick trap of, oh, we don't have to do anything until November, and then nothing happens for the next 6 months. We don't want that to happen to you all. So please continue your momentum. You've already got a good start with your prototype, and so keep going with that. And don't let money be a hurdle. You know, if there's something that you need, come talk to us, and we can see how we can work that out. And also continue to update your proposal. There are some feedback today, some things that you can make better. You'll thank yourselves later as seniors. You do not have to do a traditional thesis unless you want to. So you have two options. One is what you have now, chapter 1, 2, 3, results and discussion. If you think you have something that you might want to publish, what some teams have been successful with is an introduction, manuscript 1, manuscript 2, manuscript 3, a conclusion. Team Haptic last year had one paper accepted for publication by the time of thesis conference and two submitted, and we'll embargo your thesis to allow for that. So, you know, I don't want you to just create a product because you have to for Gemstone. It's part of the process, but if you think you have publishable data or publishable idea or product, you should go down that path. We also have had teams work successfully with the Technology Transfer Office and had different patent pieces there as well. So all of that is an option for you should you choose to do that. Do you have any questions for your committee?
I think we're good.
Any further questions, we can email you guys, right?
Yes.
And I think also I have some suggestions for you. So one thing is Trello.com, which you can write it down. This is a website for you to collaboratively record which task which guys do and what's the deadline for each task, so that you can manage your projects very well. So this is what Microsoft Research is using. Trello.com. And the other thing I noticed that for your presentation, you showed a GIF image, I guess, for your 3D globe, right? Which is not very high quality. So I would suggest you to use like OBS Studio. To record your screen with high resolution videos, so that when you show your results to the audience, they can see really high quality video.
Thank you.
Yes,
no problem.
Does anyone else have any other questions?
One other data set I forgot to mention is you might consider showing population and coastlines and sea level rise to go with it. And I have a nice population data set if you're interested. Really good.
And actually, that reminds me, because Mark Stewart just came to 102 again this week, the Sustainability Fund, you just missed that deadline for this year, but you should look at maybe applying for the October 1 deadline to the University of Maryland Sustainability Fund.
Oh, we already turned one in for
You did turn one in for January? Okay, good. I'm glad.
What is that?
The UMD Sustainability Fund. It's the $300,000 that the Sustainability Office gets from the student fees every year.
Yeah,
and
they
distribute that out. And the nice thing is it's internal money, so it's not subject to any fees. And Gemstone teams have been successful with that. If you don't get anything on this round, you can apply again from October 1. And actually, they tend to allocate larger amounts of money in October 1 than January 15th. Or October, whatever it is, October 15th, plan for October 1st.
Yeah.
All right, thank you all. Good job.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.